Okay, guys, welcome to the first instalment of a brand new series. And this is a very exciting one today. Why? Well, it's with Basing Minds in conversation with, and then little old me, and the idea is to pull out some big shot bass players from their stadium stage. Look at him shaking his head already. And then actually have a cup of tea and have a little living room chat and actually get down to basis and understand who we're talking about. Now, this week's guest, our opening guest for the new platform, I had probably one of the most surreal experiences with, and that was I texted him in the middle of probably last year and said, "Hey, Neil, you wouldn't believe this, mate. I'm about to go on stage with a Queen tribute." And then he texted me back and said, "Mate, I can't chat. I'm about to go on stage at the O2. With Queen, which was a very different footprint. Ladies and gentlemen from With Bass Mind, please welcome Neil Fairclough. Hello, Neil. How are you?
Hi, Phil. I'm very well, thanks. How are you?
I'm really well. This is such a really surreal environment for you and I, because I think we just had a little chat before the recording. We said we seem to have known each other for a couple of years now, and then we still haven't had the man hug. And here we are once again, this time on a cyber platform, and we're still not together to say hello. So here we go. We can do that.
That's
all
good.
Neil, you've been filling some very big shoes, my friend. John Deacon, Queen. Probably, well, I mean, even before you had the seat, that's going to be everyone's sort of idol gig, and now you're in the boots. I'm going to start the chat, first of all, with a massive congratulations. Queen, live around the world with Adam Lambert, number one, mate. Congratulations.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, well, I mean, obviously I can't take all the credit, you know, but I'll take that tiny 0.5 percentile of it. But it's amazing, you know, and it was a live album as well, you know. I think it was back in October they got to number one, you know. And and Brian and Roger were lovely. They'd sent myself and Tyler and Spike and you know, I guess a lot of people who were working on the, you know, knowing that'd be a nice little thing. And I remember thinking, I think they've had one or two of these. So
one or two.
I wonder whether anyone who's been in Queen goes, oh yeah, you know. No, I'm sure they don't. I know they don't take it for granted.
But, you talk about, I mean, what a franchise. I mean, you talk about Queen. I mean, I was born 1979, 42 next month. Don't forget my birthday. And you think to yourself, you go back to the Mercury early days and Bohemian Rhapsody and stuff like that. We were talking end of 70s going into the 80s that all that really kicked off. This is to still be having number one albums in 2021. Was it last month it went to number one? Is it now? So it's
2020.
What a legacy. What a legacy to be part of. Absolutely fabulous. I still try and every time I think of Queen now, I always think of Brian May on top of Buckingham Palace. I think the Queen's Jubilee. It doesn't get much more rock and roll than that, doing a bass solo on top of the Queen's house.
Yeah, I know, exactly. When he did that, I remember him telling me that he had a real struggle hearing it. So it was all like, you know, I hope this is working, you know. And I remember watching it and thinking, that is fantastic. If you're ever going to do something, you know, amazing, that's the one, you know what I mean?
I don't think it gets much bigger than that. I actually had a conversation, I want to say it was with Mo Foster, and it was when the guy, so when Roger and when Brian had an engagement with Her Majesty, and it was that typical so what do you do question, and Brian was like, oh, I played guitar on top of your roof, and apparently the answer was, oh, that was you, was it? Which is amazing.
It is brilliant, isn't it? Fantastic.
We're going to get onto the Queen thing in some depth in a little while into the chat and stuff, but Neil, you're a working musician much like myself. Slightly different.
Not this year, guys.
Not this year. Well, we'll get onto that as well, because we've got some chat about the Deacon Traps, which we can introduce to everybody at the end of the broadcast. But let's talk about Neil Fairclough pre-Queen. Neil, what's your background? Let's forget the Queen thing. Let's forget John Deacon right now. Let's just talk about you. Music education, where you're growing up. Where did you earn your stripes? How did that come around?
Well, all my family were musical. You know, my mum and dad, my dad played piano. He was a huge Oscar Peterson fan, and he loved Errol Garner as well, you know. So I knew that he was, when you see someone who's, you know, I mean, he had a job and he did his thing, but when he came back, my brother often tells the story of him, you know, you know, in the days when he smoked in the 70s, he'd be playing, and all his cares were gone, and he was like he was in a jazz club, you know what I mean? And he was like scatting away with what he was playing, you know what I mean? But he and my brother played guitar, both my sisters sang and played. So I guess it was inevitable. I mean, I was the last to get into it, really. And I remember seeing them all live, playing at a place called Masses, it was called, back in Bolton. Probably, well, it was early 80s, that's for sure. And I remember thinking, oh, you know, that's what they do and what have you, you know. But then I started to, I'd already got into music, you know, I just didn't think about playing it, you know. And funnily enough, Queen being one of the bands that where it just, it became important to me. It wasn't just something I listened to and enjoyed. I was like this about it, you know, and I got all their albums and stuff, you know. But to fast forward to, I think I was 14, heading to 15 when funnily enough, it was a friend of mine who was a guitar player and at school, and we'd go and listen to some, he was a big AC/DC fan, you know, and we'd listen to stuff because he was just across the road from the school we were at. So we'd nip across and go there. Anyway, it was, ironically, it was through him. I was going to, you know, let's form a band. Yeah, okay, you know, what shall I do, you know? And one of my sisters, Lois, was saying, you know, you should play bass. It's really cool. And she played me some Mark King, you know, on Top of the Pops.
Okay.
And I was going, oh, that is great, isn't it? You know what I mean? And so that was it. So I got, in fact, I had a bass before I had an amp. So for a few months, I was like, yeah, brilliant.
It's a great.
I think someone must have borrowed an amp for me, but I remember it being quite a while before I had my own cab, you know.
So. It was complete opposite to me. I remember my very first ever bass and guitar, and I think the guy came in and said, if you buy the amp, I'll give you the bass for free. And because it was an old H&H Electronic, which was the size of a fridge, you know, and had about an output of 6 watts. But it was, you know, it was good. Great period to grow up, though, Neil. I mean, I always say this, and I say it a lot to my students, that, you know, bass playing, although we've got a lot of idols and a lot of guys that are prolific in the industry today, like all up there, big names, and you can list them off, you know, from top to tail as much as you want. But there was something about the innovation, something about technology driving forward with, you know, effects and hi-fi bass amps, all that sort of stuff, you know, like the old Jolly Green Giants of Trace Elliott and stuff being introduced, and bass playing with the likes of Mark King and that lot, just escalating. The playing went very virtuoso, and you listen to all those bands from, you know, Duran Duran to Wham with Dion Estos, and all these guys, the repertoire, the prestige of the bass players in the 80s, wow, man, I'm not sure we get that density anymore. So kind of growing up with a bass around your neck then, you got high hopes immediately, haven't you?
Yeah, I mean, the thing is well, and not only that, you know, a lot of these guys then, you know, and you start to know about them late because you're into bass, and then you're interested in bass playing and who the bass players are. But, you know, Pino was all over those Paul Young albums, wasn't he, and stuff, you know. And yeah, you're right, actually. I think that there was a little period there where, you know, Kajagoogoo, you know, I forget his name for a moment, but, you know, amazing players, you know what I mean? Yeah. And I think that's the thing, isn't it? Is that if it sort of makes you sit up and go, oh, what's that? You know, and like you say, you know, with the lots of effects that were going on, you know, it made it seem more of a, in fact, a lot of it was bass driven, wasn't it? If you go back to I guess sort of Chic, you know, and Nile Rodgers and Bernard Edwards, and you know, those bass lines were sort of like, what is this, you know? Yeah, no, you're right, what a great time to start playing, you know.
Everything
was bass central, wasn't it, you know? And I think as well then, now you see there's such ubiquity with music and players and stuff. It seems to be everywhere and everybody's doing it, you know, which is great. But then, you know, if you wanted to see somebody, you'd either have to go and see them live if they weren't popular particularly, or you'd get to see them maybe on a show like Top of the Pops or maybe Old Grey Whistle Test, you know. Yeah. So what it did is I think it focused your attention on, oh, what is that, you know what I mean? And your interest in it was very, you know, whereas now it's, you know, I always do the example of, growing up, you know, people might say, have you heard that Rare Weather Report album from Japan? You know what I mean? Oh, no, what's that? Well, Keith's got a copy of it on cassette. Like, I'll see if I can, you know. Whereas now you just put it in and it's there, you know.
There it is on YouTube. It,
you know. Amazing.
I was thinking the other day, I found an old 8-track cartridge for the car. You know, they used to put in the cartridge. I was like, I don't even... Well, here's a sign of the times. I found an old 8-track, which was before I even drove. It was a David Bowie album.
Yeah.
Just recently, Mo Foster, living legend, who we're going to have on this chat very soon, he sent me a CD of his new album, and I realised I don't have a CD player anymore, which is... I've gone completely...
Oh my God, you've succumbed. Funny you say that. Before, we were talking about... we've had this, we'd planned it last year and stuff like that. We managed to get this little garage conversion going, utility room. This now it's my man cave stroke.
I was about to say, you're not fooling anybody, Neil. That's a man cave.
It's a man cave. Yeah. But actually, what you can't see is I managed to set up my amp and it's all Cambridge Audio and what they call them? CDs and cassettes. I've got a double cassette here. And record player, and what it's been brilliant because whilst I've been cleaning up and setting things up, I've been putting albums on, and even you and I were probably from a generation where you would put an album on and you'd hear it from start to finish, you know.
Yeah.
And then if you heard vinyl, you know 20 minutes into side one, you'd have to turn it over, you know. And it's been brilliant doing that again, because even though I love listening to albums, because of the way streaming works or downloading or what have you, or the way our lives are, it is tempting to go, oh, this reminds me of such a thing. Oh, what's that track? And then you flick onto it, you know.
Yeah,
whereas
yeah.
with this, you know, you've got to sit down, and it's brilliant doing that again. It's yeah, lovely, you know. So nice. I managed to get all my stuff here, and I was thinking, right, that's it. I'm just going to sit down and listen to music, and it's been great.
And then all of a sudden some chatty cockney demands a conversation in your privacy. That's good.
Yeah, I'm trying to listen to something here. Do you mind?
Now, Neil, you talked about musical family over your right shoulder. I can see the fifth edition real book poised on the chart there.
It's sixth good. Edition, I think.
Is it the way. Sixth? It's the Howlin' Owl one. Okay, it's good. Yeah, yeah. Tell me about musical education. How did it come about? Were you formally trained? Did you have a teacher? Did you learn to read? All that sort of stuff. Talk to me about that.
Well, early on, I went to the band that my brother played in and my sisters. I think it's Pete Jenny. I can't remember his name now. It's really bad. I'm forgetting everyone's name. Dementia right. kicking in already. But I basically had a few lessons from the bass player of that band, and who was good. He taught me some good habits, you know, the thumb, you know, behind the neck sort of thing, not sort of rapping over and stuff. And he was really into, I guess, people like Bernard Edwards, and he loved people like Marcus Miller and stuff, you know. But really, I went to a little tertiary college, Lee College, and I ended up being there, and it was amazing because I just happened to land at a time when there were some amazing teachers there,
yeah,
and there were some brilliant students there. Who and I think I was 18, and I think I auditioned with Teen Town, but my playing was better than like my reading, you know what I mean, yeah. and my theory. So I had to do a lot of this. And a couple of the guys who were playing one was a fantastic jazz pianist, and another guy was a great drummer. And so I sort of went in sort of feet first doing jazz standards and stuff. And of course, this was like a huge learning curve, because I remember I wrote out a bass line to How High the Moon. And so after the sort of AABA, I just started again, you know.
Yeah.
So, improvising yet the bass part, but it was a start. But if I hadn't gone there, I think it would have been years before I'd been in a situation where I'd been challenged like that. And then when I got into it, I mean, there's a lot of things that I was still discovering and getting used to. I have to say, there was some times I squandered time at music college because I was trying to do other things, and I found it hard to devote enough time to do that. It was only later on that I really got into it when I had my own bands and stuff, and then I got into it more. So, but after Lee, I went to Salford. I was there for a year. Wow. That was great because the same thing. I met, you know, Ash Sawn was there, and Andy Treacy and Mike Gorman and all these guys who were amazing. And by then, I was getting better at doing stuff, you know. So it was great.
What's refreshing for me, because the whole point of these conversations is to get to know the man, get to know about, you know, what you did and how you've got to the point you are. But one of the most refreshing things immediately to hear there is you're saying, oh, you know, I wrote out the bass line to High Hope, you know, High How the Moon. And it's like, okay, I understand that, you're good. But, you know, you talk about, should you be at the pinnacle of your career? You're in the biggest world touring band on the planet right now, mate. You are pretty up there. But, you know, you're playing lines from a bass player from the original Stewart. We talk about how much artistic license you get as an individual, but from one of the most melodic, intricate bass players of his generation, which was John Deacon. So it's nice knowing that you're emulating someone that has that sort of melodic vocabulary, yet your own background seems to be like there was a little bit of a jazz footprint there.
Oh yeah, yeah. No, I spent some time doing the whole checking out all the bass players, and you know, and like every bass player, when I discovered Jaco, you know, what's he doing? You know, and did that. But I think what was good was that when you meet other musicians at a place where that's basically what they're doing 24 hours a day, you become you know, engaged with their influences as well. Have you heard, like when I was at Lee, the drummer lent me a cassette of Live and in Living Colour, Tower of Power.
Yeah.
I couldn't believe that this wasn't the biggest band in the world when I first heard. This is like in the late 80s.
I still am.
yeah, exactly. And yeah. I was absolutely blown away. And for a few years, I was all about, you know, muted 16th notes, writing out Rocco Prestia's parts, you know, checking out, even to the point where I had my own band, Pocket Central, and we did Tower of Power covers and Stevie and Earth, Wind and Fire, all this stuff. Loved it. Keeping a band like that together is another story. Maybe we'll speak later. But the point is that that's the thing, isn't it? Is sometimes you need to surround yourself with a lot of diverse musicians, you know, because there may be things that you'll miss out on, never get to hear, you know, if you're just following a certain path. There's nothing wrong with that, but I'm saying the great thing about, I guess, music colleges, and it's not the answer for everybody.
No, it's definitely not.
It, you know, the good thing about it though is that it affords you that time to be exposed to stuff that you would never go searching for, you know, because, you know, but someone might be playing something or they'd suggest a tune. Who's that by? Have you never heard? You know, so you go and check them out and go, this is amazing. What's this? Yeah. You know? So yeah, for a little while I was doing that, but I always found myself attracted to sort of singer songwriters, that kind of thing, you know, a part of a band situation. Even though I love the jazz thing and salsa and, you know, African, all that. I've done bands where, you know, I was once in a band where we did folk music, but with African rhythms, you know, a guy called Kwame Yeboah. I don't know if you've met him. He played everything. He's from Ghana originally. And I learned a lot from him. His thing was that, like, in a lot of places in Ghana, they don't just think of themselves as a bass player or a guitarist. They just think music. So they can all play to a very high standard, lots of instruments, great stuff. He was a keyboardist, but he played guitar, bass, drums, but he played them in a Ghanaian sort of way of thinking.
Yeah.
And it was just, I had to write out parts just to get the vibe of what was going on. And if I hadn't done that, it would have taken me a million years to sort of try and, you know, because otherwise you have to grow up with that, don't you? You have to be immersed in it, you know.
I think the inspiration here, Neil, and I'm putting you on a platform, I'm afraid. You're going to be on a little plimp for a moment.
Don't do that.
But the point is that it's going to be guys that are watching this. There's going to be great bass players out there that are studying students. They're aspiring to get in, to be in the session scene maybe, or produce their own bands and get to a place where they can say, you know what, I've played the O2 and I've toured and I've had a number one album, okay? And they might be looking over their shoulders and going, how do I actually get there? What's in there? And there's a very big divide here that I'm seeing already, and this is in my time as a lecturer, and then where my time has now gone digitally, obviously with bass in mind.
Yeah.
But I'm noticing that there's a lot of kids now, a lot of aspiring musicians are going on the internet, seeing a piece of music, learning a 15-second lick, which they then get judged as a great musician. And their answer right. to that call is they get a couple of thousand likes and a few of their friends give them thumbs up and stuff like that. We all like positive feedback. But the thing that's evident, just this quick chat with you now, is that you went through the process of understanding the actual physics of music. You've gone there and said, you know, how do I write this out? How do I transcribe this? Yeah. What's going on? Rather than just going parrot fashion, here's a lick, do, 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 do. Okay, but instead of playing that, you go,
sounds familiar. Yeah,
that's a fourth, you know, and you're starting to learn that physics and stuff. It sounds like it's quite a valuable thing for someone that wants to aspire to get to that level that you're currently at.
Yeah. I mean, I did a drummer friend of mine, Brian Hargreaves, he got me into we used to play together a lot, but he got me into doing more Latin stuff. And at that point, I'd sort of done like one chord vibes, you know, with a tumbao playing you know, people would jam over it and that's great. But I was getting exposed to real Cuban musicians, guys who were coming over and I got into a band. It was kind of a Leeds-based band. What were they called? They were called Casa Latina All-Stars. Brilliant. And then it turned into Azuka. But the point being is that, same thing. They gave me this album that we were going to be backing this guy who was coming over from Cuba, Peachy Valdez. And oh my God, it was like, what, hang on a second. And when I was getting everything together, I found my old parts. And of course, you know, Cut Common and the tumbao, you know, they start you know, all this stuff. And the more you get familiar with it, it starts to make sense, you know what I mean? And, you know, different, you know, son clave, rumba clave, all these different things, you know. I didn't get it all down, you know what I mean? But
I got a good story about it, actually. I'll tell you in a second, go on.
Yeah. My point being, though, is that you don't have to suddenly be a top expert in that. If you can function, you know, if it's your passion, then you go for it and that's great. But I found that a lot of, I guess, session guys is that they are familiar with a lot of genres, enough to have played it, to listen to the music and to dig it and understand it to a certain extent. Well, I guess they have to understand it wholly, but the point being is that if someone says to you, Neil, I'm doing this, it's kind of like a cha-cha-cha sort of thing.
Yeah,
okay. Well, if you've never come across that, you go, what's that? You're probably thinking about a dance, you know what I mean? You're probably not thinking stylistically, what is that? Yeah. So to do with whether it's tempo or whatever. So without any of that and the chance to write stuff down, and, you know, because there were some, so those gigs, I'd written down the parts and I'm half reading and half know it, you know, that kind of thing. But that stood me in good stead for later on, because it means that hopefully you're prepped for stuff. I think preparation is the key, isn't it? I'm sure you tell all your students this, you know.
Yeah. Tell myself it sometimes as well.
But... Yeah, no, exactly. No, we all need that. But there are different things. There are certain gigs I've done where I would never write it out. I would learn it. Because Queen, for example, I've never written any of the parts out.
Imagine being on stage with...
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Imagine heard that.
Yeah, someone do the page turn for you. Neil, there's actually funny, you talk about session players and get, you know, being educated and having a wealth of exposure to different styles. I don't want to say, it wasn't the Afro-Cuban All-Stars, but it was an Afro-Cuban big band that I was depping for once at the Ealing Jazz Festival. And I came over and it was the exact differentiation that you just mentioned between son and rumba claves. Now, for anybody watching and you think we are talking a different language, well, we actually are talking a different language, but...
Español, no.
Yeah, no. ¿Cómo estás? No, okay, right now. Perdone la cuenta. No, wrong conversation. Okay, right now.
Now, I thought you were paying.
Yeah, right now. If I'm trying to be serious, you
sorry.
Right. Now, a son clave is obviously the emphasis on beat four. So you got one and two and three, four. If it's the 3-2, that's just the first bar.
Yeah.
One and two and three, four. One, two, three. And I was playing a song which was a rumba clave, which is on the and of four, one and two and three and four and two, three. But trying to be a smug ass hotshot, you know, a new kid on the block, I was going boom, 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 boom. And I was putting in beat four.
Oh, I see, right.
Like as a dead note. And I thought,
Jack,
the lad, that sounds great, doesn't it? And the MD came up to me and said, "It's Phil, can I have a quick word?" He said, "Yeah." And he pulled me over and he said, he goes, "Phil, this is Alberto." I'm friends of him actually, still Alberto. I said, "Hey, Alberto, how you doing?" He goes, "Yeah." He goes, "Phil, Alberto plays the clave." And Alberto got out these two rosewood clave sticks.
Yeah.
And I said, "Okay." And he said, I pay Alberto 150 quid or whatever it was at the time. It probably wasn't that, to be here to play the clave. And I said, "Right." And he said, "And he plays one and two and three and four and." I said, "Right." He said, "Good. So shut the fuck up." And that was my baptism of fire learning Afro-Cuban.
That's the perfect example of it. Yeah. You know, you have to make mistakes. Yeah. And you know, I've been guilty of worrying about that. And sometimes to the point of like, oh, should I take this gig? Because what if I cock up and, you know, this, that, the other? Well, you are going to cock up, and that's the way forward. You know, you can't not make mistakes. You know what I mean? There were some gigs that maybe were a bit heavy reading gig, you know, and I was reading, but I was thinking, oh, is this going to be okay? You know what I mean? And it's all right. They'll forward the parts to you. Oh, okay. Yeah, I'll take the gig, you know, but you worry, you know, when you're younger, you think, oh, what? And that's why I think preparation, it's not that you have to be like the finest sight reader in the world reading fly shit, as they say, but at least to navigate the geography of a chart, you know what I mean? I've done stuff where I've just completely gone, oh, I've blown it here, you know. And you have to learn from your mistakes, otherwise you won't next time go, right, well, what do I need to do to stop that, you know. That's a good point, you know what I mean, knowing the differences about this stuff. But if you hadn't been pulled aside and told, That story. Now you won't ever forget the difference.
You know? Oh man, there's been some harsh lessons. I remember one of them was playing with Van Morrison, and let's just say I played the wrong chord at the wrong time, and I found out it was the wrong chord very quickly. Callie was in the auditorium. I think she was at the back, and she heard Van shout at me.
All right,
it's good. We're talking about sitting in bands. We're talking about skills. There's obviously a musical pedigree that's been upheld here. Let's talk about just prior to the Queen gig, because that came around. Neil, forgive me if I'm wrong. You can fill us in here, but was it Wogan? You was with Ilio Pace?
Yeah, sorry, I'm cleaning my glasses. I did some little smudge that's annoying me.
Yeah,
that's the same about me. See, I was saying it about me. Anyway, I've worked with Elio. I first met him in the early 90s. He was a good friend of my sister Susan, and they went to Leeds College together, music college, and they just stayed in touch. And one day he was doing a demo of a very early song of his, and I think Susan was like bigging me up and being a sister, you know. So I said, "Oh, you should hear my brother. He's great. You know, he'll come and do it whatever." Anyway, he took her up on it, and I ended up borrowing a wall fretless. It was a beautiful instrument, actually.
Yeah.
And anyway, I went and did the session, and he loved it, you know. And it was great. You know, we had a good time, and we stayed in touch. And then a gig came in, you know, and so. From there, I started working with Elio.
That's the Billy Joel songbook, isn't it?
This was, you know, we were doing his own material, and we were doing, anything, you know, all sorts of gigs. And he started the Billy Joel songbook back in 2014. There are some gigs where. The thing about people like Billy Joel, and you know, I include Queen and stuff like that, is that they have an eclectic sort of catalogue, don't they? There's no way really of getting bored, because you know, one minute you're playing a pop thing, and then it's a hard rock thing, and then it's a funky thing, and then it's a huge ballad that's, you know what I mean, and then half of these in Queen's case are like huge songs that you're just going. The problem with Queen is, and Adam, is that they have a problem about what to leave out. You know, some of our, we do a set list and you know that there's another 10 or 15 songs, absolute bangers, as people, the kids like to call them now. Yeah, as the kids say, that they're just not including because maybe in this part of the world they weren't, that they're big, but not as big as this particular track, you know what I mean, or whatever, or we'll go, you know. So it's always great. And the same with the Billy Joel songbook. It's so full of fantastic tracks, you know, and every one a winner, you know. So that's good. But yes, to cut a long story short, back in 2010, Elio was given the task of being a musical director for something called Weekend Wogan, which was Terry's, I guess, kind of like swan song. He'd sort of officially retired, yeah, but he came back to do this program, which went out on a Sunday, I think between 11 and 1, and in the day. And we'd have a Saturday to rehearse stuff. And what happened was, is that one day, so different people would come in and we'd have charts, or we wouldn't, you know, and people would send the tracks that we're doing and maybe whatever, but usually we'd have stuff there and we'd do, Elio would have three tracks that he did and we'd come in with any artist. Sometimes guests would come in who would have their own band, you know, or a band in itself, whatever. Anyway, it was really good and it was really exciting. For a year, we you know, I'd get the train every day about whatever, 5 o'clock in the morning to get to London on a Saturday. And we would rehearse stuff. One day, Alan Boyd, the producer, said, I remember I was talking to someone and he said, in his lovely Scottish brogue, he said, next week we've got Brian May coming. And I literally went, excuse me, did you just say Brian May?
Wow.
Because it was this visceral feeling. It wasn't really to do with the, first of all, there is the musician side, but it was, I went back to my childhood straight away, you know, and I was like, oh my God, you know, because I knew, I was such a nerd about Queen, you know. He said, yeah, he's coming in, and he was working with Kerry Ellis, who's a fantastic West End singer. And they came in and we worked with them, and basically, as much thanks to Kerry and Brian, they sort of liked what we did. And after that broadcast, Elio came back and said, look, they want to use us for Proms in the Park, which was like a month later. Okay. And that happened, and literally, and nothing happened until the year after, where we did the Anthems tour. They'd sort of got half a band together and then they used some of the guys with Elio. And we did a tour with Kerry, dotted, you know, here and there gigs throughout the summer. Yeah. So everything that kept coming in, I didn't expect any of this. It just kept getting better and better, you know. If we only did the one thing at Wogan and we'd stopped, that I could have died and gone to heaven, you know, that was fine by me. But it kept going, you know, until the point where I got an email saying availability, you know, and I thought it was for Brian. I was going, yeah, I can do that. I've just come back. I think I depped for Shaking Stevens, actually. Wall is a bass player when mine, and he had to cover us something. It was great, and they're all great guys. It was a great gig, you know. And I said, yeah, I'm available. And it was only through Roger's drum tech, who'd worked with us, because Roger's son Rufus played drums for Kerry when we did it, and he teched for him. And I said, is Brian, are they doing, you know, what is it, you know? And he said, nah, mate, he said it's Queen, you know. I was going, you are joking, aren't you? And he said, I'm not, mate.
Sorry, just tell me to go. Do you just tell me that you got offered the gig for Queen from an email?
Well, do you
I'm
know what?
I'm pretty sure we can rewind this if you want it, Neil.
only in hindsight, because it was an email just to, I don't think they literally had any plans to do anything more than this, what is called the Global Icon Award. Right. And they'd got, and Adam was involved. So I'm getting bits of information, you know, and it turns out it was in Belfast and we did the arena and they got this guy. And we did it, I think it was 7 or 8 minute medley. We did The Show Must Go On, and I think we did Rock You and Champions a little bit. I can't remember what it was, but it was something like that. And that was definitely like, right, I can't believe this, you know. I got to, we had a rehearsals, you know, with them and stuff, and met Adam. who's like incredible, you know. The whole thing was quite mind-blowing because I just kept thinking about my childhood, you know.
And they
can never know. It must be weird if you're someone like Brian or Roger or any Paul McCartney, whatever, because you can never know what you mean to other people because you're just you, aren't you? And
that's it, yeah.
Everything you've done has been your music career. You know, I'm sure they're used to the fact that people go mad when they see them, but to actually have that kind of effect on people's lives, you know.
I think also the difference in perspective for you, I mean, you know, like you said, I mean, I've played Queen songs, you know, and I've done a Queen tribute. We laughed about that at the beginning, but to actually then be playing those songs with the guys that compose them, it's a different level, man. How did you go about like preparation? So let's not talk about rehearsals. I'm talking about Neil at home. What happened? Did you get the set list? Did you go back to the original recordings? Did you go from a live disc? Was there charts? Talk to me through it. Was Brian on the phone going, now, Neil, you know, talk to me. What happened?
Yeah, in the fifth bar of Killer Queen. no, I think the thing about it was definitely no music, no charts. I think they, you know, this is the one thing you realise when you get up on stage with Brian and and Roger is that they're a rock band.
Yeah.
And just between the two of them, it's like thunder, you know.
Yeah.
His sound is so magnificent when he plays. You're literally like this. You know, it's so loud, but it has to be, and it's got this sound, and it's amazing. Same with Roger when he starts playing. He's got, you know, Roger's got his way of playing with the hi-hat and on the backbeat. You know, he does this, he fattens the snare drum, and there's only Roger. You know, it's Roger Taylor. You know, it doesn't matter who. You know, I guess it's like all these guys that you get used to in a band, like whether it's Charlie Watts or whoever, you know, Ringo Starr, you know, they have their idiosyncrasies that are built into their drumming DNA, you know. And it's the same with Roger, you know. So when you hear him, you're going, yeah, that's it. That's the thing, you know. That
sounds just like the CD.
Like you sound just like Roger Taylor, yeah. I was kind of left to my own devices with the expectation that I would turn up and I'd know what to do. And they were never, they were never heavy about anything. They even said, you know, don't feel you have to do everything the way, you know what I mean? Just this, that, other. But of course the nerd in me, Phil, was going, no, not let's get this down. So I went to I always went from the recordings as being the Bible.
Yeah,
and there were occasional live stuff that from like Live Killers or Live in Montreal that I'd spotted some stuff. But what I found was is that if you didn't play certain things, even if Joe Public didn't know that, for example, in Killer Queen, Fastidious and Precise, if you don't play that run, people might not know why, but they'll go,
"Something's not right.
What was that?" You know what I mean? So the point is that I wanted to get all that right for the music's sake, you know what I mean? There might be the occasional thing where they'll say, you know, when we land on this note, just hold it there so that, you know, so there might be the odd conversation there, but they never got on my back or don't ever say to me.
It's a wonderful thing you're talking about because, you know, you talk about the anthemic stuff where as soon as under pressure drops, the whole place goes mental, which must be a proper buzz for you, mate. Oh my god. And then you play Another One by Stars, all that sort of stuff that people know as those sort of those anthemic states, we call them stadium tracks. But actually it's the intricacies, and the same thing, absolutely, I'm not trying to piss on your fire here, Neil, but I did the same thing. I transcribed Killer Queen, but I did it dot for dot for the, and it was it was like 8 pages. It was huge because Deacon's playing was so magnificently intricate. He was so melodic. Yeah. And like you said, you take out those little things and all of a sudden someone, probably me in the front row, goes, what did he just do? You know? And
Did you see what he did wrong?
I could have done that. No. So tell me.
I think you're right, Phil. I mean, the thing is that what was special about John is that he was able to have these little moments without treading on anyone's toes.
Yeah.
It all worked, you know. And I think as well, Brian once told me that he didn't want to be told the chords verbatim. He you know, he just said, no, okay, that's fine, I've got it, and I'll do my thing. So that's why with John Deacon, you'd get, maybe they were composed, but they were, he'd do a lot of inversions, you know what I mean? Yeah. And he'd do a lot of things, pedal points maybe on certain things, or he would, certain lines, where, and you think, oh, that's great. The thing about Queen is that they all had very, whilst they all loved the same stuff, they also each had quite disparate influences, you know. You know, you tended to get a lot of the rock stuff from Brian, and, you know, Roger had his vibe. John and Freddie also embraced the soul funk side of stuff, you know. And that, I think, is how special it was. You know, I think that they didn't stay still. A lot of bands, you know, who were great, they just didn't move, did they? And so they were sort of in a time capsule of ways. I think that they wanted to stay interested and stay interesting.
Yeah.
And so when you look back, I mean, I've always, here's an example. I always say, if some alien came down to Earth and they could perceive music the way that we do, if you played them 1975's Bohemian Rhapsody, 1980, Another One Bites the Dust, and then 84, you played them I Want to Break Free, there's no way in a million years they'd think that's the same band.
No.
You know, and I know people go, hang on, is this Queen? You know, I've watched some reaction videos from people in America who maybe don't know, you know, maybe they've been more into sort of rap or stuff, you know, and they're checking out Queen for the first time. So they do these reaction videos, and they're going, is this Queen? No way, man. You know what I mean? And they're blown away by the fact that it's the same guys that were doing Rhapsody or Somebody to Love or whatever, you know, and that's what you're faced with every night when you play. I'm sure when you did the gig, you play it and go, this is amazing. You know, yeah. Where else do you get a chance to do that? And then there's the vocals and the composition of it all. You know, it's brilliant. You know?
Great. Okay, so you've gone through all the preparation. You've gone through sitting at home, going through proper geeking out, you know, different tracks, different recordings. You know, if Motro, you listen to Wembley, you listen to the Kind of Magic stuff. You know, where do you go with it all? And then D-Day comes. Now, D-Day for me, D-Day's never... It's never, I'll get the mic in the right place. It's never the first gig. For me, I think the most important moment is the first time you walk into a rehearsal room. Because this is the first time when, I mean, let's talk about prestige. We know, obviously, about drums and guitar. Adam Lambert, oh my God, probably some of the most memorable performances from American Idol has ever been. For me, I'm not biased, one of the best male voices on the planet at the moment. Absolutely phenomenal. This is quite a jury you're going to be confronted with, Neil. So you're walking in, and it's and here is Neil Fairclough, and you walk in. How does it feel, mate? Did you leave your stomach outside the room? Did you tie it up before you went in? What happened?
I just made everyone cups of tea, and I knew I was in. No, I think what it is that... you're right, you're concentrating on, you know, don't screw this up, make sure everyone's okay, don't be too much of an arse. No, what I mean is that, you know, be yourself, be nice, you know, get on and just sort of I don't know, there's a million things going through your mind, but you're sort of thinking, when we get to playing, you know, the truth is, though, is that they're very relaxed about it, you know, and they won't sort of, like, you know be like, well, we've got to get this. You know, I think that they've done it for so long that they have a confidence, not in an arrogant way, but in a confidence in the material and how they present it. And when you've got someone like Adam, who, let's face it, the Queen catalogue, it's not an easy sing. You know, Freddie was not only a fantastic performer and singer, piano player, composer, you know what I mean, and to have all this in his head, you know what I mean, he was, well, I mentioned to you, but he was a vocalist that most people go, oh my God, you know, I mean, you know, this, I always remember, I think it was Seal, when they did the tribute, he said, you know, there was a lot of key changing, you know.
I do remember that, he did Who Wants to Live Forever.
Yeah, it was either him or maybe Robert Plant mentioned it, I don't know, but you know, all these great guys,
yeah.
And you know, it really, it's Adam just sort of, he's able to go from Killer Queen, you know, and sort of camp it up to rocking out, doing the pop stuff, and then some sort of sensitive, you know, he's made things like Who Wants to Live Forever, you know, his own, you know what I mean? He's been able to do that. And of course, they've got this fantastic production with it. And I think what it is they want people to leave after, you know, 2+ hours thinking, right, you know, they've had some escapism for a while. They've escaped what's going on in their lives and in the world, you know what I mean? And they've inhabited this place where it's all about the music and everyone's together. Because a band like Queen, I mean, if you think about the anthems, you know, the amount of singing that the, you know, put it this way, ambient mics are important for their recordings. Right. You know. And the energy from the audience, you know what I mean? It's amazing, you know.
There's a lot of pressure on you, isn't it? I mean, I've seen footage of yourself with the guys just doing pure vocal performance, like rehearsal, where it's just the four lads, you, Adam, Brian, Rog, and going through harmonies and stuff. Was vocal something that you already had a big grasp on? Or was there a, shall we say, a pending push right at the end? I remember being asked, well, we talk about Elio, your breed, but obviously Elio was with Albert Lee and I did some runs with Albert Lee. And having to, can you sing the fifth? And can you sing the third on this line? Yeah. And me going, yeah. And then all of a sudden going home and going, what's that? So I mean, tell me about that, because there's a lot of pressure on the vocals for you, right?
I guess there is. I know that I've always been interested in that. I wouldn't, you know, I've done the pocket thing. In the end, I started doing lead vocals and I've actually done an album doing that. But I sort of, not yet to be released, but I don't have a problem with that, as long as I know I'm a singing bassist and I'm doing backup. I love that. So, you know, I'll sing full throttle and I've got quite a high tenor voice, so it's all good. Tyler and Spike as well. Tyler's got an amazing singing voice as well. He does percussion and backing vocals with us. And so the three of us, Spike, Tyler and I, will run stuff. But what's great about it is that because Brian and Roger sing as well, and they've got such a sound, you know, that when we're all singing, it might be a three or four part, but let's say it's a three part, but it's doubled because we're all, you know, I might be sharing something with Roger or Brian or whatever. And so the fact is it comes out, and then I know that Tom, our out front guy, will maybe add some, I don't know, maybe a chorus or thing to give it, whatever. And the point I'm making is that it's these guys are sort of old school in the best sense, that there's nothing on track. You know, there are no vocals on track. And like you said, the pressure to get it right and sing it. But it's everyone's sort of good at it. You know, they enjoy doing it. So we do it. And I think we had a situation in 2014. I remember Roger being fairly, and I think we're all a bit annoyed about it because it's, you know, it's the way that the music world's become. But they'd said something like, you know, great backing vocals, insinuating that they were a bit too good track, you know, on track.
Right, okay, yeah.
And you think, hang on, you're busting your...
To get it perfect, and then you're getting criticised for not.
And then people are saying, oh, well, it's on track. Are you thinking, no, there are bits like interludes and samples that are plagued maybe by Spike, or there's obvious video bits like the operatic section of Rhapsody, but we all go off stage like they always did. So there's always going to be bits where we're not playing, but they always make a big deal out of we're not playing now, but this bit we are. So, but when the band's full tilt, it's all us, you know what I mean? And so that's where the pressure lies, is that you need to get it right. Yeah.
The stagecraft is something that we really should touch on a little bit, because there's a very different perception that a lot of guys that are watching this might not actually even be aware of. I put up a little scenario whereby, from a personal perspective, you know, I spent, God, 15 years playing clubs and small venues and stuff like that, and then things changed. I started getting some bigger gigs, and there was a couple of things that really, you know, were very difficult for me, and that was I went from using a big rig in a club to then going on to big stages and using the smallest possible thing ever and going on in ears. And you wouldn't think that. You'd think if you're going into the biggest stadiums ever, you need the biggest bass rig ever. But you don't. It's the opposite. You go on in ears, it becomes even more isolated with all the theatres and things like that. And then those dreams of the wall of stuff, it kind of gets smaller. Harky user, I think that's a pretty standard thing that we know there. We can see it over your right shoulder as well. It's loitering back there. has there been any crossovers for you, Neil? Because obviously, you know, you've been a working bass player for some time. We've talked about, you know, your heritage and that prestigious stuff with Elio, with Wogan, etc. And then, bang, 60,000 people, open air stadiums and stuff like that. What was the crossover? What was the big thing that was a shock for you?
Yeah, I think sound is a big deal. There's certainly a certain amount of compromise because the amount of volume and because of the space that you're dealing with and it coming back. Actually, it's arenas that can be a little bit troubling because you can get, you know, in an empty arena when you're sound checking, you can get the slap back, you know. Yeah. But you just know that when people are in, that will improve, and then you know. But that's why I think the in-ear thing has really made a difference to a lot of people, because you're able to then get a sort of crisper, especially like with, I'll make sure I've got tons of Roger. So I've got his hat, his overheads, but I've got his kick, snare, hat. Obviously I've got everything in there, but those are the things that I'm locking in for. And I'm always watching him. If we're coming out of a phrase, yeah, I'm always watching him because you know, it doesn't matter where I think, you know, I just want to come out with Roger, you know? So on these big gigs, you know, it looks like we're close together, but we could be 20 feet away, you know? And funnily enough, like you say, I mean, I've got stacks behind me, but I'm only using the middle two. I'm only using a 15 and a 4x10. Everything else, I used to use more, but we realised we didn't need it.
Everything, you know, else is just a show of testosterone.
Well, this is the funny thing. In 2017, we did the News of the World sort of anniversary tour. So we had this look. It was, you know, the big robot thing and a bit metallic. Yeah. And I remember... Roger was looking at, and he was quite right, he was looking at, I had the four, I had two 15s and two 4x10.
Yeah.
With the LH1000 heads. Yeah. And he went, yeah, he said, it doesn't look big enough, does it? It's like, what, you want more? Yeah, yeah, I think that'd be good. Hartke, you know, yeah, I mean, no problem. and we do that, and we took the grills off even, you know.
So it's all bare cones.
Yeah, so it's all bare cones on that one. And the point is that I think with Jez, bass tech, Jez Webb, I've got four LH1000 heads, two running and two spare.
Yeah.
But I've also got these LH1000 heads. They're just dummies. They don't do anything. Yeah, you know what I mean? You'd think they'd plug them in and put lights on, but I mean, you get into detail, you're thinking, well, why are we drawing all this power for just for something that's...
Remember that thing we were saying about bass players? Oh, is he playing the right note? Now I'd be like, look, the little red LED's not on in his amp. Yeah, he's a fraud.
Because all the power is off stage, you know what I mean?
Neil, John was... Deakey, obviously, was a big P-bass user. He had the Music Man as well. Did you go authentic? Did you adopt that into your plan? Were you using different instruments prior to Queen? And then you went on to those instruments. I remember going and doing some Jameson gigs in town on one of the West End shows.
Yeah, well.
I had P-bass. I hadn't played a P-bass.
Did you put your foam in?
I grew a tash. hook. Yeah. But you know, that was it was a thing for me. I used Spectre basses for a very long time. Was there a similar thing, or was you already on P basses and stuff like that? Because I know you've got...
I already had a 76 P bass, which was like a tank. I mean, when I'd... I think a lot of the 70s basses were quite heavy, and I think you had to be careful with certain Fender ones, which I ended up later on selling. But I did have a P bass. But now I've got a 74 P bass, and I've got two sort of... One's 2011, one's 2012 P basses, and I've got a Music Man and a chocolate anniversary, something or other. Yeah. Or unless I think it's chocolate.
The old smoothie is the same as mine, mate. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
So yeah, the old smoothie.
That's it.
So basically, yes. Yeah, so 90% of it is P basses all the way. Some of the tracks that go from 73 to about 76, I use flats on. And then some, later on than that, I do round. Doesn't always work out that way, because it might be that we'll go straight from one track. You know, they might do a little bit of a medley, so I can't be doing this, you know, when we're running from one to the other. So there might be some compromise there. But yeah, it's that sound. You know what I mean? The P bass is just so good on recordings, isn't it? And as simple as it is, it's very versatile, isn't it? I think it's versatility in its simplicity. And it's all the player.
As I always think, Leo probably had a time machine, went forward and said, yeah, okay, I need to design an instrument can do all this. Then jumped back in with a flux capacitor, went back and designed it, and then here it is. Oh, yeah. So good.
They're still stacked away. They were ready for our next tour last year. So I still haven't got them. They're still somewhere, you know. I'm sure I'll probably need to look at the neck and get them looked at again by the time we get these cobwebs, you know.
If you need a tech. No, right. Well, listen. So we've gone from little old Neil. He's grown up. He's got his gig. He's gone onto stadiums. This year, mate, has been catastrophic for most of the industry because of the COVID pandemic. It's had a big footprint. You've been keeping yourself busy, though, haven't you? Because Deacon Traps...
Deacon Traps. You're obsessed with Steely Dan, as we all are.
So you got some new stuff out. You had a new single out. You got a new video coming out promptly. Tell the guys about the project.
Yeah, well, this was born out of a few years back. We were... myself and John Dagnall, and actually my sister, who's married to John, Lois Dagnall, we sort of started, pooling our talents in terms of, right, they'd been doing stuff and I'd been doing stuff. And we got a chance to work with somebody who was thinking of doing an album. And long story short, that didn't work out for various reasons. And we thought, do you know what? We love what we've done. We want to carry on doing this. And we just came to the conclusion that, you know, let's just do it ourselves, you know. This was still a few years back. The story of getting this together will make a fantastic first three chapters of a book. You know what I mean? We've had so many obstacles shoved in our way, you know, one thing, that, and obviously when we're trying to do other things as well. But yeah, so eventually, because all the touring had stopped and because, you know, people, we just thought, well, why don't we do it? Why don't we just give it a go this year? You know, with the albums pretty much almost done, we could do one track at a time and just maybe try, you know, we're under no illusions. You know, we're not expecting to be, you know, this massively successful straight away. You have to build an audience, don't you? You know, so we just want to see if we can get people on board who dig what we do, you know. And it's, I think what it is it's a rock, more of a rock thing. And I quite like that because I think there's a lot of different narratives you can go down with that, you know, because it's such a, you know, like the genre of rock can be from folk to metal, you know what I mean? But there's a lot in between, you know. So we explored a lot of that. And I guess they were born out of what we were going to be doing, you know, in the past, but we carried on with it, and we've now got a lot of the guys who are in the band. We've known each other since we were like 17, 18, 19, you know, so it's funny that we've all reconvened, and they've done sessions and worked with people. Andy, the drummer, has worked with Faithless. He toured with Faithless for 15, 20 years, Groove Armada, stuff like that, and you know, so yeah, no, it's really been one of those surprising things where I think, actually, we've got to do this. And in doing so, we've realised just how much work it takes to sort of, the way we look at it, because it's, you know, it's costing us money to do this, you know. But what's important to us is to try and do it right and get stuff out there. And so the effect is that you've got like the swan, you know, the top sort of looking smooth, and underneath you've got this this stuff that's, you know, you're sort of thinking, we need to do this. And then of course you sort of put it out there and go, yeah, what do you think of that? Whilst, you know, like up until the day before, we're going, I need to sort this out, what's going on?
Yeah, I know, it's the same.
You know, but no, it's been really, really good. And I hope we get a chance to play live at some point, you know. But we've got a magnificent singer, Ricardo, who's just so expressive, Ricardo Afonso. He's our ace in the hole, our secret weapon, I think. And Neil Edwards on keyboards, and Johnny Hayes on guitar, Andy Treacy on drums. And we'll just see how it goes, really. You know, I know it seems like I'm underselling it, aren't I? But I'm trying to say, you know, please like it, you know. But
I think there's two things. First of all, send my love to Andy. I've known Andy for years.
Yeah, we'll do.
But I think what's been really nice there is the updated Freud We know about Freud's iceberg theory with the tip, and now it's it's Fairclough's swan, which is what we can talk about. But I mean, what's been lovely for everybody who's tuned in for this little chat, and Neil, thanks for coming to join us on the With Bass in Mind platform. But the is that what's been really evident here is the grand opening, whether it be with the new project or with Queen, and this is the absolute car crash of high blood pressure and stress until you saw that perfectly calm high, you know.
It's like running around a corner out of breath and going, hello, you know.
It's all good. It's nothing to be good at. And you know what? You're mortal, mate. It's been brilliant. It's been so lovely to sit down and have a good chat with you and that lot. Guys, first of all, we're going to put the link for the band, Neil's new projects, right here on YouTube. They're also going to be shared on Neil's Instagram page, my own Instagram page, and with Bass in Mind platform. So if you want to go and check out the releases, I think it's Sun and Moon was the last stuff that came out, wasn't it?
That's the new one. Yeah, that's the new one. The first single was Moonlight. And this one's Sun and Moon. We're not obsessed with celestial objects.
And the first jazz song you learned was
How High the Moon.
Yeah, okay, here we go.
Amazing. and then we've got a new track after this. We've been held up because of COVID and restrictions. Fair enough. So we're hoping to get a video done for this next one. And this next one we're very excited about as well because it's full on big bit of an epic track. And that escapism, that's us. We want people to enjoy themselves and get lost in the music. I don't want to be telling people bad news when they don't need to hear that. They want to escape all that, don't they? You know.
Yeah,
so,
but
you know what, Phil, as well, thank you so much and congratulations with your Bass in Mind. It's been going phenomenally well.
It's a growing baby. It's a work in progress, as we all are, so it's all good. Guys, please show some love for Neil. Get on his pages. Go and check out what he's been up to. Obviously, when we're graced with his presence on stage with the mighty Queen and new projects, show some support, get out there, send some love. Guys, I've been Phil Mann. This is In Conversation with Neil Fairclough of the mighty Queen. Check him out. He's a little smiley face. If you like what you're hearing and you want to hear more from the platform, then please don't forget to subscribe to With Bass in Mind right here on YouTube. And then pop over, go and check out withbassinmind.com. There's loads of free resources on there, from Bass Player magazine articles from me to a load of free transcriptions. And guess what? Yeah, I'm not. Of course I'm going to go there. If you go up there very shortly, there's going to be a little John Deacon transcription going up there. Neil, do you know what? You might want to go and sort up, because I've seen you play live and there's a few... No, I'm joking. It's so good.
You know what? There's a lovely bit in I Want It All where we go to... you know, the little, the way it sort of double tempo faster thing where Brian solos, you know, and it's the one place where I just sneak in the old Rocco 16th stuff in, and I feel like a naughty boy, you know, because normally it's like these eighth notes, but I'm going ding, digga, digga, ding, digga, and I'm sort of going, I'm getting away with this, but no, they're fine with it.
And there's going to be a link to that in the YouTube page, should you want to go on and have a look at it. So that's okay.
Well, no, it gives it a drive, yeah.
No. Guys, I'm Phil Mann. This is Neil Fairclough. This has been With Bass in Mind. We'll see you next time. Thanks a lot, guys. See you soon.